for enhancing our livelihood, for enhancing our way of living. But one thing which I want to portray is about how sustainable are we in pursuing technological growth? Are we making our life more easy, or are we putting into more miserable situation? One example which I want to give is about today's technology of internet, technology of mobile. We are so dwelled into the technological entertainment that we do not know what is wrong, what is right. What I'm trying to say is, along with technology, we should also, you know, be moral. Technology should come with ethics also. Technology should come with humanitarian approach also. Technology alone would not be sufficient. Namaste to everyone who have come here for the talk. And as you all know, today we talk about history of science in India. And myself, Sabareesh, I done my PhD from JNU, and my area of research has been traditional medicine knowledge and IP rights, with also some aspect of philosophy of Indian science. And my area of interest has also been history of science, because right from my school days or my college days, I got opportunities to be a part of Vigyan Bharati, which is in Kerala. And from time to time, I also heard about, you know, various contributions of India towards science. But when I was a part of JNU, so at that time, I also came across a lot of documentations, a lot of reading materials on Indian science. And that is when, you know, I got the opportunity to pen a book. So, A Brief History of Science in India is about the briefest possible way to understand what Indian science is and its contribution to the globe is about. So, coming quickly, it's any area of knowledge is void without a vibrant education system, and we all know that. And when it comes to education, India was one of the prime place where, right from the ancient period till the modern world, it was a prime place for education, and scholars across the world had poured into Bharat. So when we say education, we should definitely use the term gurukuls, mutts, ashrams, pathshalas, which broadly formed the, you know, indigenous education system. And the English people termed it as open sky schooling under the tree, which definitely was the gurukula system or the pathshala system. And of course, apart from pathshalas and the gurukuls, we also had universities during the ancient and medieval India. And quickly going to some of the prominent universities of Bharatvarsha is Takshashila, which is in Gandhara, which was in Gandhara, Nalanda, Udantapuri, Vikramshila, and Telhara in the modern Bihar region, Sharda Peeth Temple University in Kashmir, Vallabhi University in Gujarat, Pushpagiri in Odisha, Somapura, Bikrampura, and Jagadala in modern Bangladesh, Morena Temple University in Madhya Pradesh, Kantalur Shala, Ennayiram, and Tiruvottiyur in Tamil Nadu. Mostly they were all temple based university systems, and in also in Nadia in Bengal. And definitely they all had a diverse education system, including science. And as I said, that learners came from other countries like China, Korea, Indonesia, Japan, West Asia. And the travelers like Fahian and Hyun San, they have greatly described how these universities performed and how they contributed towards knowledge generation and knowledge building across Bharatvarsha. And when we say Bharatvarsha, it not necessarily means the modern political map of India, but also includes Afghanistan, Pakistan, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, apart from other smaller countries. And we definitely know how the education system came under the attack by both Islamic forces and also through the European colonialism. And definitely the example of Nalanda is very well known across the world as to how Bakhtiar Khilji, just because his religion, the Islam, didn't confine to the knowledge as propounded by the Hindu thought, just because of that the great Nalanda University was destroyed. But the British were more cunning and they didn't directly attack the university system. They came through policies that could gradually give it a slow and steady death. And this is definitely well documented by Sri Dharampalji in his book The Beautiful Tree, about which we'll be explaining, hearing soon. So the vast knowledge base and the foundations which we see in our Puranas, in our Upanishads, in our Vedas, were all fundamentally laid in the Gurukulas or Pathshalas or Ashrams or Mutts, and also the universities during the ancient and medieval period. But why, how was our education system destroyed? And this is very well seen in the surveys undertaken by the British. Because when they came, they had a good understanding about the physical attributes of the land, as to what sort of people lived here, their way of living, and the resources available in the subcontinent. But they did not have idea about the society and the core aspect of society, which is the education or the knowledge systems. And hence the Madras Presidency, Bengal and Punjab, the presidencies initiated extensive surveys. So this one by Thomas Munro, he during the period of 1822-26, he had initiated the survey in Madras Presidency, which included the districts of Mangalore, Srirangapatnam, Tirunelveli, Coimbatore, Madurai, Tanjavur, Madras, North Arcot, Chengalpet, South Arcot, Nellore, Trichy, Machilipatnam, Vishakhapatnam. So all these, which mostly constitutes the current states of Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, because all these states formed the Madras Presidency greatly. So they initiated the survey so that in Madras Presidency they could understand what sort of education was imparted, if at all, to the boys and girls of the region. So the results of survey was a bit shocking for the British. And when I went through these reports, I mean, while researching for the book, I too was like really both happy and shocked, because this particular information was hidden away from us, was totally taken away from us for whatever reasons, which we will be coming to. And the results of the survey in Madras Presidency, it showed that every village in the Madras Presidency, it had a school. And there were a total of 12,498 schools and colleges for a total of population of 1.28 crores, approximate population. And approximately for every 1,000 people in the Madras Presidency, there was a school. So seeing this, it is if you're comparing the ratio with the current system of education, it could come probably much higher or maybe equal. And this was the result incurred from the Madras Presidency's education survey that was between 1822 to 1826. And coming to the Bengal Presidency, from 1836 to 1838, they made another survey. It was done by Adam. So the report's name is also Adam's report. And the districts of Bengal, Rajshahi, Murshidabad, Birbhum, Burdwan, South Bihar and Tirhut. Maybe many of you would be definitely from some of the districts, and maybe from South also. Many names of the district in Madras Presidency would be the current one also. So similarly, in this survey also, the survey showed that 1 lakh village schools in about 1.51 lakh villages in Bengal and Bihar till the 1830s. And every village in Bengal and Bihar had at least one school. 100 institutions of higher learning in each districts of Bengal. About 1,800 institutions of higher learning with their own buildings spread across 18 districts, which house some 10,800 scholars. Several teachers were from lower caste groups, students majorly from the lower caste in surveyed areas. I am picking these words directly from the report. So when the narrative which are being thrown upon us that the casteist based education system was there since the ancient period, then it is important to show this report to all those people who spread those narratives. And in spite of better conditions of the education system in Bengal, Adam used his own arguments, his own intention for narratives to say that the indigenous education system in India has been decayed and it is recommended that the British take over these schools and run them financially. He recommended these to the British Empire in India. And again, another survey in Punjab Presidency. It was done by G.W. Leitner, who was principal of Lahore Government College. Two reports, education of history of education in the Punjab since annexation and indigenous education in Punjab in 1882. Both the reports are available online also. And the results of survey was that before the British annexed Punjab, there were 3.30 lakh students who were trained in reading, writing, mathematics, Sanskrit, Arabian, Persian, philosophy, logic, law and medicine in the highest standards. After the annexation of Punjab, the numbers decreased so drastically, it reduced to almost half, to 1.90 lakhs, with drastic and irrecoverable degradation happening to the education system in India. So across India, the education system had degraded after the British intervened to change the system. Same system that was very well established for centuries together, that had propounded several perspectives of alternative education system, and they replaced it with a totally alien Western model of education so that they could condition the Indian masses. They could take into their hands the minds and the brains of the Indian masses so that they could plunder and rule India without any bothering. And it is important that what Dr. Leitner, after survey, observed. Dr. Leitner was not like Adam. He was more generous towards the indigenous education system. So he said that about the drastic degradation of education in Punjab. He said, respect for learning has always been the redeeming future of the East. To this, the Punjab formed no exception. We have changed all this. He's quoting after the annexation of Punjab. We have changed all this. The annexation disturbed the minds of believers and the true education of the Punjab was crippled, checked and is nearly destroyed. So all these happened in all the places wherever the British went. And the education syllabus across India was rich, was multidisciplinary in nature. It included science, arts, literature, philosophy, law, religion, grammar, drama, poetry, history, logic, textiles, Vedanta, statecraft, military strategy. Because the intention of Indian education system was to make a person, was to make a student into a holistic person. Be whatever situation he or she is being put through, the person should be able to overcome that. So various disciplines were imbibed into the education system of Bharat and it was imparted graciously to all the students who had been a part of the education system in India. Some of the examples are given: Gavya, Paita, Vaidya Shastra, Nau Shastra, Chaturangam, Hastiludyam, Tarkashastra, Jyotisha, Mauna, etc. Some of the examples I have taken. It's an exhaustive list. The book A Brief History of Science in India, it gives an exhaustive list if you see, but not all can be covered. So I am giving some terms which can be comparable to today also, because most of the words are still in use. But the education system had one thing in common, that is the Hindu philosophical fundamentals. They were common. And about dharma, be it about dharma, be it about karma, be it about Hindutva, the education system imparted had these qualities as a basic thing. So in 1822, when all these things were happening based on these reports, Sir Thomas Munro, the governor of presidency, he said that we have a great understanding about, you know, the agriculture, about the industry, about the various resources, demography, and how the people lived in this land of Bharat. But they had no idea about what these people studied and what was the fundamental aspect of this land. And then, but these surveys, all these surveys, it helped the British to generate views and narratives about the indigenous system of education. And amidst all these surveys, we have our, you know, our forefather. I heard someone saying Macaulay's children's. So if we are Macaulay's children's, then probably we can say that he's also a grandfather. So we have our grandfather Thomas Babington Macaulay, note down in his minutes on education in 1835. He says that we must at present do our best to form a class who may be interpreters between us and the millions whom we govern. A class of persons Indian in blood and color, but English in tastes, in opinions, in morals, and in intellect. To that class we may leave it to refine the vernacular dialects of the country, to enrich those dialects with terms of science borrowed from the Western nomenclature, and to render them by degrees fit vehicles for conveying knowledge to the great mass of the population, which we are, if we ponder deeply, even after around 75 years of independence, we still are Macaulay's children. And it's high time we appreciate ourselves that, you know, we need to come out of this particular framework of Macaulay's children. And Macaulay again spoke of education with respect to India, and that with the House of Commons in London. He said, to provide education of the church to the poor, who on the verge of a revolution, the year is 1847, and our first war of Indian independence was in 1857, who on the verge of a revolution tends to dissent or rebel against the ruler. Doing this was the simplest way to prevent a revolution from happening, rather than thwart those who revolted. He knew that revolt is going to come, that is why he made this statement. And the revolt came, and after the revolt, whatever they did is history. On the same education tradition of Bharat, Gandhi, he recommends, he went to London and he spoke these words on the diminished state of education system in India. He says, I say without fear of my figures being challenged successfully, that today India is more illiterate than it was 50 or 100 years ago, and so is Burma. Burma was also part of, because the British administrators, when they came to India, instead of taking hold of things as they were, began to root them out. They scratched the soil and began to look at the root and left the root like that, and the beautiful tree perished. There are statistics left by British administrator which show that in places where they have carried out a survey, ancient schools have gone by the board. Because there was no recognition for these schools, and the schools established after the European pattern were too expensive for the people, and therefore they could not possibly overtake the thing. This very poor country of mine is very ill able to sustain such an expensive method of education. Our state would revive the old age village schoolmaster and dot every village with a school both for boys and girls. These statements were made almost 100 years before, but they match today's circumstances also. They highly match today's circumstances wherein education has become an industry. It's become expensive for people who are financially weak to pursue. So such type of education, which was multidisciplinary in nature, that was a thing which provided Bharat with continued scientific ideas and concepts, technological and engineering excellence. But why did the British want to again destroy our centuries old education system, so that they could westernize us and so that they could impose the evangelization process on India? And to recourse the intellectual process of a society and the practices in the Indian population by replacing the existing social system with the Western thought, so that they could easily rule us. There would not be any stoppage to them, because they have directly reached out to the masses. They have brainwashed your brains. That was the intention. And assertion of Christianity as an alternative religion to Hindutva thought is also a reason, because the British Empire had the church's blessings and they would not stop. So through repeating conditioning of the subconscious mind of the nation, it was possible to a very large extent. So it is important as to, you know, when a nation, different nation is coming to this much larger nation, and how were they possible, how it was possible for them to be successful. So they had the knowledge of India as to what the power of Indian subcontinent is. So they were all prepared to suppress the knowledge systems here. So I want to present some instances of scientific excellence in the history of Indian science. Some examples, some are case studies, some are some concepts, so that we get a glimpse about how rich the Indian sciences were and how important its technological process were, and how importance Bharat was given across the globe, so that someone from all the way from two continents away is coming to you to destroy yourself and take the name credit. First example is the oud steel. We all must have heard about the Damascus sword. Damascus sword is made out of oud steel, and it's Indian origin, which is an example of metallurgy. The term ouds is derived from an Indian word called uruku, about which I'll come in later. So some literary evidences about the importance of metallurgical expertise in India. One is the Varahamihira's Khadaglakshanam, in which he talks about the production techniques of sword, such as the carburization, hardening process of high quality iron swords that were very famous and very well known since the 4th or 5th century BC. Some historical evidences are like the use of iron tipped arrows at the Battle of Thermopylae in 5th century BC. King Porus gifting iron steel ingots to Alexander's army in 326 BC. Import of Indian steel to the Abyssinian ports. Swords that are made of Indian steels and its export to European countries through Persia in the name of woods or Damascus steel. And some of the early medieval steel producing centers are these, like the same Gujarat, Kutch, Assam, Bengal, Bihar. So we are broadly industry based economy. So steel making was an important process, and without which industry would not have been possible. And the so this particular term oots, if you see the etymology of that, it is derived from the word uruku. Uruku in the South Indian languages, be it Tamil, be it Malayalam, be it Kannada, or be it Telugu. Uruku means molten state of any metal. In this case, it is steel. So even now also the word is used, uruku. Anyone who is a blacksmith, he uses the word uruku still. So it is derived from this particular word, and by the time it reached the West, they are not great pronunciators. So they couldn't pronounce, and just because of that, they had already changed the names of many cities in India, so that they could easily telegraph the pronunciation. That was also one of the reason. So the word derives from this. And oud steel was also known as Hinduvani and Pulad in Arab countries. And the Indian style of swords called as Hindvi swords, they were much sought after because of the lustrous nature. It was very much sought after. And the second instance is Indian rockets, which led to the evolution of Congreve rockets. Congreve rockets is basically UK based first rocket system during the Napoleonic Wars and all. So we have evidences to say that Rockets were immensely used in the defense of forts and also during warfare as early as 1563 by the Vijayanagara Empire, by the Marathas, by the Mughals, by the Mysore Kingdom. And some of the literary evidences is like Akasha Bhairava Kalpa, Rajavyavahara Kosha by Raghunath Pandit, mentioning of rockets as projectile, offensive projectiles, such as the terms are important, the Bana, Agneyastra, Agni Nalika. These are the terms used to define the rocket as an instrument. And some historical evidences are also there, the rockets being a part of Vijayanagara army in the Battle of Talikota against the Deccan Sultans in 1563. And they were mainly used in the warfare to, you know, to frighten the war elephants and the army formation so that it could, they could totally be dazzled away. And in the third battle of Panipat also, the Marathas had used against the Afghan forces. We also have colonial evidence to show that, you know, the rocket, use of rockets in India was much earlier. One British officer called James Forbes in 1775, he describes how the Marathas used the rockets. It was an iron tube, cylindrical in nature, which could travel like 900 meters. It's a good distance, seeing those times. And it had iron swords also, so that it could create havoc among the horses or the elephants or the battle formations. And even Tipu Sultan also had used these rockets. But before them, the Marathas had also used. So these rockets were adapted into the British after, during the Anglo-Mysore War and during the Anglo-Maratha Wars. The British were quite impressed about how much havoc these rockets created on the British army. So William Congreve Jr., he, after studying the rockets, he took the prototype Congreve rockets and presented to the Ministry of War in Britain, and then British Prime Minister William Pitt. And then Congreve rockets were ultimately used by the British for use against Napoleon, at the Battle of Waterloo also. We all know what happened at the Battle of Waterloo. Napoleon ultimately lost and the British became European supremacist. And another instance is about medicine and surgery, that is rhinoplasty. It also is related to Anglo-Mysore War. Again, Tipu plays a role in this also. So, an Indian Parsi car driver named Kovasji of the Bengal Presidency, he took part in the Anglo-Mysore War of 1792, and he was caught as a prisoner of war by the Mysore Kingdom. And Tipu being what he was, he chopped the nose of Kovasji, he chopped away the hand of Kovasji and left him alone, that you are free to go. So the noseless, the handless Kovasji, he roamed around for 1 hour. He was made a pensioner by the British English army. And after 1 year, he got the help of a surgeon in Pune called Kumar. And in 1793, he was given an artificial nose on the basis of Sushruta Samhita, the knowledge prescribed in Sushruta Samhita. And the successful surgery was witnessed by two British medical officers, Thomas Crusoe and James Findlay. And they documented it in the Madras and published the documentation in Madras Gazette in 1793. And this article was reproduced in the Gentleman's Magazine in London. And that is when the Europe came to know about a surgical procedure that was earlier unknown to the entire Europe continent. Though the procedure was immensely in use since the ancient times in India, but the documentation reached Europe only in like 1794. And 20 years later, in 1840, Joseph Constantine Carpue, he performed the first Indian rhinoplasty surgery in England using the same techniques by cutting the skin and muscles of the forehead and giving it about nose job. These days they call it nose job, giving it an artificial implant. So in 1816, he, through his book, an account of two successful operations for restoring a lost nose from the integument of the forehead, that was the first time when a research article, a research book that became immensely famous and which talked about this particular Indian procedure of giving a nose, because those were the time where wars took place, and the soldiers lost nose, lost whatnot. So they were given this procedure gradually, and then the intent type of rhinoplasty was performed in Germany, in USA, and other parts of the European continent. So this is the Gentleman magazine's report, which I took from the directly from the magazine's archives. And this is the photo of Kovasji, wherein on the forehead you can see, you know, some amount of operation has been done, and on the nose also, on the bridge of the nose also, some sort of thing has been done. But this is like 11 months after surgery was done on him. It perfectly looks fine. And this on the right side is the rhinoplasty performed on another diagrammatic inscription, wherein the lost nose is there, on the other side how a flap from the forehead was taken away to give a temporary or an artificial nose, which was as depicted by Carpio on his patient in 1814. So this is the part wherein whatever explained it comes. It says that the third line, the third last line and the last sentence, this operation is always successful, which means that there were other procedures wherein after the implant, after the surgery, there was some fungal infection or there was some sort of uneasiness in the patient which caused pain, which caused decay to the tissues. But this particular documenter, he says that this operation is always successful and the artificial nose is secure and looks nearly as well as the natural one, nor is a scar on the forehead very observable after a length of time. This picture from which the engraving is made was painted in January 1794, 10 months after the operation. So the picture is totally fine, and those who know, you never know what people claim. We need a high definition photo of Kovasji. I'm sorry, I cannot give that, because these are all those things available those times. So you can read this by, you know, pausing the video, the viewers. So, and another instance is about the Bowers manuscript, which would cover medicine and health sciences. Bowers Birch manuscript, also known as Navaneetakam, is excavated in Kashgarh, which is in the modern Xinjiang region. Of course, China doesn't own Xinjiang, we all know that, but this particular case study will tell who owned Xinjiang, the region in those times. So the archaeological dating goes back to 370-50 to 475 AD, hinting us to the period of reign by Emperor Samudragupta. And Navaneetakam is a collection of 7 manuscripts, which elaborates on medical treatment using garlic, which is Lasuna Kalpa, and elaboration about indigestion, about hair loss, about cough related remedies. And it also contains elaborate sections on Rasayana, Vajikarana, Ashotana, Mukhalepa, Anjana. These are all various treatment procedures as per Ayurveda. The second part contains details on internal medicine and is seen as an important masterpiece of Indian medicinal literature. And this is the Bowers manuscript, which was Navaneetakam excavated in 1886. The person who excavated it was Bower. He was a British archaeological officer and he named it after them. But technically the treatise is Navaneetakam. So based on whatever you want to call, you can call. I would call it Navaneetakam. And fifth one is Zero. And the archaeological evidence behind it is the Bakshali manuscript. The concept of Zero or Shunya is definitely, we all know, it is India's greatest contribution, or else we would have still now been use the, you know, Arabic way of numerical system. And its contribution to mathematics and other sciences is immense, because without Zero probably we would not be counting, you know, much. And the modern system of numerical writing, it reached Europe through the Arab region and was originally known as the Hindu numbers before being termed as Arabic numbers. And the evolution of this concept of Zero, it was not instant, it was gradual. It took time for the development of Shunya, and it got newer dimensions also, and its usage in fractions, decimal place system and value system is well known. And so this zero particularly was initially a dot, which which denotes this doesn't exist, and it gradually evolved into, you know, what we use, the modern oval shape. So in India we have several literary descriptions and complex philosophical interpretations also about shunya, which people who are into pursuant of meditation or spirituality are can philosophically explain this very well. So this Bakshali Brij manuscript, it was written in the ancient Sharada script. Sharada script is one script which was immensely used in the Kashmir region, and it was discovered in 1881, as I said, and it is one of the world's oldest existing manuscript to and it has a recorded symbol, which the photo I will show. And definitely today's computing and science and technological process would have been void without the contribution of zero. So this is the manuscript in which shows, if you can see the bottommost line, you can see some of the digits like 3, 4, and we have a dot in between, which that was the thing which described the shunya. And the another instance of scientific excellence in the history of science is contribution by Maharishi Panini, who was a grammarian scientist, I would say, because these days we talk about linguistic science and how language itself is a science. For that, Panini's Ashtadhyayi is the greatest example of how it is algebraic in nature, and how the algebraic in nature of Sanskrit forms the basic component for technological, you know, programming, all those things. So his Ashtadhyayi is, as I said, algebraic in nature and matches the requirement of modern computing. And it, and how the Ashtadhyayi became so scientifically enriching that it creates a modern revolution in the computing industry, is because Panini, he created set of rules, set of finite rules and regulations, and through the combinations he could create greater number of rules and regulations, which was definitely algebraic in nature. And the natural language processing is what forms the basics of this modern computing. And so Ashtadhyayi derives linguistic forms and Sanskrit words from grammatical elements in a systematic way by using about 4000 grammatical rules, 2000 verbal bases, and some 261 list of lexical bases. Another instance is about Madhava of Sangama Grama. He comes from the modern day Cochin area, and he probably is the greatest scholar of the Kerala School of Mathematics. And as we talked about Guru Shishya Parampara, he had initiated a long lineage of pupils under him, and it continued for almost 200 years. Some of the names of his disciples are like Parameshwara, Damodara, Nilkanta Somayaji, Jeshthadeva, Chitrabhanu, Shankara Warrior, Achyuta Pisharati, Narayana Bhattadri, and so on. And they all had their own lineages also, but they all revered the main guru, that is Madhavacharya. So Madhava's contribution, it is about derivation of sine and cosine powers, value of pi correct to 10 decimal places, corrections to infinite series that enable quick and better results. And Madhava's pi, sine and cosine power series were rediscovered about 250 years later by the European scholars Wilhelm Leibniz, Isaac Newton, Thomas Fannett de Leigne, Abraham de Mowbray, Leonhard Euler, among others. It is easy to say that same thought can come from everywhere, but there are proofs to show that these knowledge, it was taken away by Jesuit priests of Cochin to Europe. It was presented there also, which was sold back to us with different name, just like they say, you know, old wine in new bottle. It was sold back to us. So Madhava's works on mathematics were known to the Western world through the papers published in 1834 in the journal Transactions of Asiatic Society of Greater Britain and Ireland by Charles Wish, who revealed that works of Newton, Leibniz, Gregory and others who lived during the 17th and 18th centuries were but the rediscoveries of the contributions made by the Kerala School of Mathematics. Some of the known works, and his legacy is so knowledgeable and enriching that researchers are still studying his works to translate and to bring out. There has been, in fact, lack of research on particularly about Madhava, but I think in the upcoming days they would do. And another one is about Taj Mahal. We all would have heard many places that Taj Mahal is a temple, Taj Mahal is a, you know, architecture, it's a Hindu type of architecture. So I was really interested to look into the factual basis of this, and only to take away, only to know the truth about Taj Mahal, I spent at least 2 weeks, though the book has about like one or two pages of information about the truth of Taj Mahal. But it took a lot of time because many, many knowledge about this has been suppressed. It has been suppressed, lot of lies has been manufactured, lot of different truths, so-called different truths has been manufactured, so that you don't, not able to find which one of these are the real truths. But my research is based on literary evidences, by reading research papers published by, you know, by architects. And one of the research papers is published by Current Science. That is the it's a journal published by the Indian Institute of Science. So anyone who is questioning the Indian Institute of Science, they can question directly the editor of Indian Institute of Science. So whatever I'm telling, I'm directly quoting it from the Indian Institute of Science paper. So this particular masterpiece, Taj Mahal, it was built by the efforts of native Indian architects, designers, artisans and craftsmen in accordance with India's traditional building principles, metrology and measurement units. This for those who call, you know, about the Islamic architecture, that Taj Mahal was built on the basis of Islamic architecture. There was nothing called as Islamic architecture. The local craftsmen, local designers, they built it, they modeled it and they built it, thereby arriving at a grid pattern design that was in practice since the Harappan civilization, which has also been mentioned in the Arthashastras. The measurement units, measurement techniques has been mentioned since the Harappan period used, and it has been mentioned in Arthashastra also. Bachanama, an important literary document of the Mughal emperor, it shows that he had originally acquired this building, which we today call as Taj Mahal in Agra. It was originally a palace, and he acquired it from Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur for the reburial of Shah Jahan's queen, Arjumanand Banu Begum, or Mumtaz Mahal, in 1632. She had earlier died in Burhanpur in 1631. So after 1 year, she was excavated from Burhanpur. Her remains were brought to Delhi or brought to Agra, and she was given a reburial. This thing is not known to many, because of whatever reasons, this thing is not known to many. And Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur has previously inherited the palace as an ancestral property from his grandfather Raja Man Singh, which initially had a temple type of architecture. So after acquiring it from Raja Man Singh, Raja Jai Singh had transformed it into a palace. But you can only transform a building, you cannot totally recreate, because the architecture is fundamentally the same. And the fundamental architecture of that particular piece of building is temple architecture in nature. It was after procurement of the palace from Raja Jai Singh by Shah Jahan that the palace was converted into a mausoleum with whatever required religious adaptations, the erecting of minarets, the designs, decorations, and that is how what we see today. And the carbon 14 dating of a wooden sample of the northern gate door of Taj Mahal, it validates the year to 1359 AD, that is plus or minus 89 years. So therefore, the building originally was erected during, as per archaeological evidence, it was erected between 1270 to 1448 AD approximately. So that is nowhere between what the modern history claims about Taj Mahal. The specifics of Taj Mahal, it also represents several symbolic aspects that resemble Shiva temple, and of course can be confirmed only through further archaeological examination. So another instance of Indian history of science is about the shipping culture of India during the ancient and medieval period. It's a 5000 year long history of maritime history. We have recorded history and starting from Indus Valley civilization. Terminology wise, the word nav, which means boat and is the root for navigation and navy, for the English words. And in Arthashastra, Kautilya describes the times during which sea voyages can be taken and not. And only later on that it was that Europe had set standards for navigation, and after learning from the Indians. Because we had a vast coast and we had this southwest monsoon coming, and we had a natural scope to explore the oceans by capturing the ocean winds. So the Greek, Roman and Southeast Asian material sources are proof to the fact that Indians practiced deep sea shipping and not just coastal navigation. The Lothal port as the Harappan dock for berthing of ships during early 3rd millennium BC enabled maritime trade between the Harappan and Mesopotamian civilizations. These are some of the important Harappan and late Harappan ports on the west coast of India. And during the Mauryas, Guptas and late periods, the ports of the west coast were, these are the reports on the western coast. On the eastern coast also we had these ports. Many of the names you can coincide with the modern terminologies, but these were the ports of those times. Some of the literary and historical evidences of India's shipping culture is in the Matsya Purana, wherein they talk about the tide and its causes. Samudravanika Jataka, the Tamil Sangam literature, Purana Nooru, Ahana Nooru, Silapadigaram, they describe about tide and the knowledge about the ocean. Vedic and Puranic literature such as the Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Atharva Veda, Markandeya Purana, Varaha Purana, Vishnu Purana, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Yajnavalkya Samhita, Brihat Samhita and Manusmriti. And some of the Greek writers and Roman literary records show about how much the Indian trade industry was fledglingly building ship industry. That is, we have a case wherein the shipping industry itself is an export industry. We used to export ships. That is what I am trying to say. During Nanda and Mauryan period, and how King Ashoka sent his son Mahendra and daughter Sangamitra who sailed from Tamralipti to the Ceylon. And Kappal Sathiram is another Tamil treatise which talks about how the sail should be unfurled. And Angavija, a Kushana period Prakrit manuscript on shipbuilding, and Kalidasa's Raghuvamsha, and military conquests by Samudragupta, Chandragupta, Vikramaditya, by the Chola kings, by the Pandya kings, and the invention of Matsya Yantra, which worked like the modern day magnetic compass, which made shipping more easy. And the 11th century treatise Yukti Kalpataru by Raja Bhojadeva. It talks about different types of ships and which ship is meant for which season. This is also being recorded there. And the Archimedes excavations in the Tamil Nadu, it reveals South India's maritime relation with Roman Empire. The archaeological excavations at Archimedes and Pattanam, that is a Muzuri's port, they are very important archaeological sites from the perspective of maritime trade. And the Pallavas and Narasimhavarman, they had waged war against Ceylon, and the Sangamera literary work, that is Manimegalai. So we have so many literary evidences to show how deep and how deep knowledge we had about our about maritime trade, about maritime explorations, maritime voyages. So, and again, as I said, the Chola Empire, which was maritime superpower in the 10th century, starting from Rajaraja Chola, and the undisputed paramountcy of the entire Indian Ocean, which prevented piracy, which prevented invasions via ocean, which prevented competitive traders from getting into the mainland, and how they had set up kingdoms in faraway Southeast Asian nations such as the Central India, in Sri Lanka, in Maldives, and also in the entire Malay Peninsula, including Indonesia. And Rajendra Chola, son of Rajaraja Chola, pursued a consistent and aggressive maritime mercantile policy and occupied Sri Lanka, Maldives, the eastern coast, Indonesia, Sumatra and the Malay Peninsula by the year 1025 AD. So, we have so much of history, that is what I am trying to say, that maritime history of India itself is a discipline on its own to research upon. And again, the Chera dynasty, how the Sri Vijaya and Chola empires, they had controlled entire the Bay of Bengal trade aspect. And another one thing is about Dr. C.K. Raju sir, who in his book Cultural Foundation Mathematics, he talks about navigation, an instrument called Rapalagai, which helped the Indian sailors to travel deep ocean instead of going into the coastal shipping only, because we used landmark as one of the spot to show where we were. But this particular instrument, it was very much helpful for Indian sailors to use to do deep sea shipping. And it was using the help of an Indian sailor that Vasco da Gama, he traveled from the Kenya, and he landed in Calicut in the year 1498. And he traveled in just 20 days, because he directly traveled from Kenya to India with the help of an Indian sailor called Kanha. And again, so amidst all these European colonialism, we have an interesting concept. We have an interesting case study, that is intellectual imperialism. They not only took away our resources, but they also thieved our intellectual capacity. And it was not only British, it was also the Portuguese, the Dutch, the French, the Danes. They all had their own share of profit and success, but out of all these, the British were the most successful, and they reaped the most valuable profit of all of them. But everyone has their own share of violence, their own share of imperialism, mercantilism, cash crop cultivation, and they have their own adharmic activities to do in the subcontinent. And their empire in India was built on all these sins, I would say. Imperialism, mercantilism, cash crop cultivation, monopolistic trade, extensive taxations, exploitation, loot, treachery, slavery, brutal violence, genocide, man-made ferments, church-sponsored inquisitions, ethnic cleansing, religious conversion. Money was literally minted out of colonial power by literally drenching the pagan blood. Pagan is a derogatory term used by the West for all those religions who are non-Abrahamic in nature. It is important to also accept that alternative knowledge is equally important. Not necessarily everyone should go the Christian or the Islamic way. So that is why I am using the word pagan blood. And the knowledge was also thieved. Indian calculus by Nilangan Somayaji. It was copied and transmitted by Jesuit priests of Cochin to the church in Europe for navigational purposes. And suppression of alternative ideas has always been, is still, one of the important landmark of Western civilization. Wherever they find an alternate knowledge being coming up, they go there and they just do whatnot, thwarting and preventing the shaping of an alternate knowledge has been one of the important aspect of colonial pursuits. And systematic distortion of Indian science history was taking place in a full-fledged way. The philosophical concepts and the knowledge systems of Eastern civilizations, it actually contradicted the views of the church and also the religion of Christianity, and therefore they thought everything should be suppressed, because they had already erected a civilization on the basis of the Bible. So if at all a different civilization comes up and says that no, our civilization is better than yours, so it would be a havoc for the church in the West. So that is the reason why they thought alternative knowledge system should be thwarted, should be stopped from being pursued. And we in Hindu thought, we have the cyclic phenomenon of time and space. That is, we do not have a concept called judgment day, wherein the end of the day, there is an end, there is a beginning, because we believe that there is no end because there was no beginning. So this contradicted the thought of the church, the most fundamental thought of the church, the most fundamental concept of fundamental idea above which Christianity is built upon. Because every Christian, every Muslim believes that there is a judgment day. Maybe in Islam the term is different, but the idea is the same. He I have took birth, I have a death, and I need to answer for all my happenings, whatever I did. There is judgment day. But we don't have. There is in Hindu thought of living, we always have an option to redo things, to do things in a better way, to do. So this was like cyclic versus static view of time. And that was really hurting for the British, and that was of the reason that with the advent of church, with the blessings of the church, they certainly did not want the other civilizations to thrive. And so there was also political involvement into this to showcase the spirit of Europe and to create intellectual amnesia about India's intellectual abilities. And even Max Muller also had fallen for this. And then came the Aryan invasion theory to bring about a divide between the southern and the northern part. But all these things were done so that, you know, the nation called Bharat will not strive upon, will not go ahead. So what do we incur from all the learnings? What is the way forward? Is that we need to explore diverse aspects of our traditional knowledge systems, because our traditional knowledge systems are very vast. My PhD research has been on traditional medicine knowledge. That itself is a vast subject that I had to pinpoint and come into a very minuscule aspect of traditional medicine knowledge. And that also seemed so large to me that the more you scuttle, the deeper you go, the broader it is. That is the beauty of our traditional medicine knowledge. And we need to pick knowledgeable lessons from the past for the assessment of success stories, examples, and for the generation of newer ideas and the implementation of required techniques and scientific concepts. So because of all these things, history matters. We need to look into our history as to how enriching it has been. Because just because some colonial power told us that you are nothing in the past doesn't mean that we should keep it away. We should definitely go into a history to look at what we were in the past. And this indeed can help the future decision makers to pave a path and to not repeat the same old mistakes from happening. And of course, India's soft power are immense. We have definitely initiated the Solar Alliance, the International Yoga Day, COVID-19 vaccine was a revolution from the Indian perspective. And so these all give, you know, global acknowledgement to what India is, and a greater opportunity comes to explore our philosophical thought, our scientific ideas, our political acumen, what we were in the past. So quickly before concluding, I want to say, quote General Mukund Naravane, Manoj Mukund Naravane sir, who told about Atmanirbharta or self-reliance, which is the key to staying ahead of the technological curve to win over our adversaries in a world of disruptive technologies. Because the change is coming so fast that every day the change is happening. By developing, enhancing and reinforcing capabilities through institutional cooperation and collaboration. So that is the reason why, you know, I'm emphasizing that history matters, at least for India. For others, our history doesn't matter, but for India our history matters, because that shows what the identity is, and with that identity we all are involved with, because that is our national identity. So thank you for your precious time, for having come here today. And the book is available online at the website of Garuda Prakashan and also at the Play Store app. And I feel that this is a book worth being placed at the school libraries and college university libraries, because in the days to come, I'm sure that history of science is going to be a fledgling discipline in India also. The West has already realized it, how history of science matters to take forward their civilization. And we are still lacking behind. And definitely, viewers who are watching from abroad, they can definitely purchase these books. And you can write to me also at my email ID, sabareesh.jn@gmail.com. Thank you very much for your time. Namaste.
Sabareesh, you talked about India's traditional education system. Can you elaborate it more that how it can help in India's quest for technological self-reliance?
See, technology is the current term which we use for, you know, for propagation of science. The terms or the impact of technology would be this, would, can be different, but in those days also we had some sort of technology or some sort of methodology, some sort of research ways to pursue our scientific ambitions. So technology is one thing which, you know, which implements some of the aspects of science, core science, whatever the core science or core scientific principle is, the technology transfers or transforms it into something that is edible. For example, we have radio sciences, but mobile is something which is an example, technological tool to propagate that particular scientific idea. So in this way, we need to explore our ideas, ideas that have been said in the past. Not necessarily all ideas can be of importance for today. So it is a thing that wherein research should take place. What are all the ideas that from the past can we take to implement or to convert it into a technology or to convert into an invention or to convert into an innovation wherein, you know, in the modern perspective, we have trade aspects, trade prospects also. So it should match several of the aspects. And I think technology is something, you know, which is actually governing the modern world in all aspects. Because someone who is technologically superior can be said to be a superpower. So in today's world, there are multiple superpowers, not necessarily only the US. There are parallel superpowers because they have their own technological technological achievements to portray in front of the world. So I think, but technology can be used for, no, for enhancing our livelihood, for enhancing our way of living. But one thing which I want to portray is about how sustainable are we in pursuing technological growth? Are we making our life more easy or are we putting into more miserable situation? One example which I am giving, I want to give is about today's technology of internet, technology of mobile. We are so dwelled into the technological entertainment that we do not know what is wrong, what is right. What I'm trying to say is, along with technology, we should also, you know, be moral. Technology should come with ethics also. Technology should come with humanitarian approach also. Technology alone would not be sufficient. Technology should come as to how it can make our life better, happier. Competition is fine, but again, end of the day, anyone who is not happy is miserable. So I want to give this particular perspective because it's about history. When we talk about history, we also take examples of how technology has been adversary against us, against the humanity itself. So I think I have answered a question, but you can definitely cross over in case.
So basically, I've got 2 to 3 questions separately, but if I may come across, so firstly, how do you see our Bharat in a couple of years when it comes to our youth? Like, the youth doesn't get involved in our history. They have their own opinion towards Western culture. They are always, they can be seen indulge in Western culture, like it's what, singing, food, meal, traveling. Even though in our Sanskriti, they don't believe in all such things, they usually call it as rubbish. So, is there any way we can diverse this thing in such way so that they can go and read all stuff like this?
Okay.
Are you getting?
Yeah, I got a question. No, I got a question. So I would prefer to first answer this and then you can come to the second question.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe you can frame it in mind. So I fundamentally find that the Indian youth, mm-hmm, or any Indian youth over the generations, whoever has been in their youthful life, they're very much explorative. They want to explore things. But just because we don't have a roadmap as to what needs to be explored. So someone who has a roadmap will present you that you should explore this. That is the reason why, you know, we are trying to emulate, we are trying to interpret the Western model, be it in fashion, be it in literature, be it any way. Anyone who has a plan for you will take your time away. So I think it is important that we explore our own history first. It is important to compare the Eastern civilization and the Western civilization and the damage that the Western civilization has already caused or is causing or would cause in the future. The case studies are available everywhere. What we should follow and what are the aspects we should explore is important. Explorative mind is really good, but what you are going to explore is what the internet has so many things, but what is it that you want to explore in the internet? Whether you want to explore things related to your interest, or you want to just surf, keep surfing, or just kill time, is about your understanding of what you should explore. So explorative mind is very nice, and we should understand that every human being has its own potential. One who taps the potential gets successful in life. Others are still trying to tap the potential. That is, I would say, I would not say that someone has failed, someone has been successful, but everybody is tapping their own potential, to tap their potential, and someone who has tapped the potential is trying to climb greater heights. So I think we should understand that we have potential to explore various aspects, and one should, you know, use the youthful days to explore positive ways.
Following the second question, we had many gurus. We had many gurus in our past, be it from Sanatan Dharma. Basically, I believe Sikh guru were also from Sanatan Dharma. They are still part of Sanatan Dharma.
Yeah.
But nowadays, we come across many cases that Sikh people or our brothers, they demand for another country like Khalistan. To be very frank, straightforwardly, I'm asking this question. So, in past, were there any similarities or were there any conflicts between both of us? If you know anything, like they give some sort of example about the past. Since we are not student of science, I mean history, so we don't know about the past, but do you really think that we had some such conflicts that we still have, we must still fight about the past?
See, the conflict inflicted upon the Hindu society, it was so unbearable that Guru Nanak thought that there has to be a separate sect to defend the Hindu society, because all the attacks were on India from the side of Punjab. So Guru Nanak probably thought that, not probably, definitely thought that there has to be a defending barrier from the Islamic forces of preventing them from attacking the mainland India. That is the reason why he found Sikh theology as one of the aspects. And definitely after that, continuing gurus, they had their own contribution, but the contribution of Guru Gobind Singh ji to form the Khalsa, to form a particular sect, or you can say a particular method to defend and to create awareness among the Indian youths about our own history, because what has been done to our history is not told to us. The current generation does not know the history in its true sense. We are being spoon-fed distorted history. Our history is biased. Our history is not the truthful in its entire sense. Our history tries to satisfy the perspectives of only Islamic. Islamic perspectives are being portrayed. But again, if you see Islamic, it was Islamic forces that inflicted so much of damage on the Indian demography. Those are not being told. So only when the Indian youth or the Indian population comes to know about the true history of this land, that we will start feeling proud about ourselves. I'm sure that my Sikh brothers would not have known their history as to why Guru Nanak Ji, as to from starting from Guru Nanak Ji to Guru Gobind Singh Ji, why they had fought tremendously against Islamic forces. So many gurus of the Sikh Panth, they all have been beheaded. They were killed so brutally just because of the reason that they did not accept Islam. Imagine that a leader of a sect is being beheaded, is being cut into pieces. You can imagine the happenings which took place for the common man. How mercilessly the invaders were upon us. And this has not changed much. Now, in those days we were inflicted physically, now we are being inflicted intellectually by putting a barrier on truth. And that is why we are being served by our history. So when we start knowing our true history, I think majority of the problem which we are facing today will stop. I hope I am clear.
Yes.